Let me first introduce Dr. Hemma Ramrattan Lomax, Vice President and Associate General Counsel Compliance at Zendesk, where she leads the global integrity and compliance function. Prior to Zendesk, she served as Senior Corporate Counsel in the integrity and compliance team at Snapchat, and as a director in the global ethics and compliance management team at the Walt Disney Company. Probably most importantly, her first job was as an intern for Securities Docket, which is my company that runs this conference, when she was at Georgetown Law School. And look at her now. She also previously served for 10 years at the SEC in the Enforcement Division. Next up, Susan Resley, our moderator. She is the leader of Morgan Lewis's San Francisco litigation practice, and she too served in the SEC's Enforcement Division right out of law school. Her clients today range from boards of directors and audit committees during investigations to public companies, C-suite executives during litigation, and class actions. Welcome, Susan.
Thank you.
Very pleased to welcome Luke Tenery. He's a partner at StoneTurn. His perspective will be terrific on this panel. He's a consultant with nearly 20 years of experience helping organizations mitigate complex cybersecurity, data privacy, and data protection risks, so a perfect fit for this. Also a certified chief information security officer. Welcome, Luke.
Thank you.
Finally, very pleased to welcome the SEC representative on this panel, David Zhou, an assistant regional director in the SEC's San Francisco regional office, a member also of the Enforcement Division's Public Finance Abuse Unit. And David previously served as an AUSA in the Southern District of New York. Welcome, David. Thank you for joining us. All right, Susan, let me turn it over to you.
Thank you. So a recent survey conducted by Thomson Reuters concluded that of all of the risks faced by legal departments, the frequency and complexity of regulatory changes is what really kept them up the most at night. The SEC's rulemaking activity has been extremely frenetic, just at a breakneck speed. And it's predicted that roughly 24 new rules will be finalized. Of those rules, three areas that we're going to cover today are at the top of the SEC's enforcement priorities, and that's cybersecurity, ESG, and SPACs. And breaking it down even further, two of those three come in second and third, cyber and ESG as you know, items that really keep GCs and legal departments up at night. We have a great panel perspective that can help wade through some of these minefields. So let's go ahead and get started with cyber. So David, why don't you get us up to speed a bit? The SEC has proposed rules, and that certainly isn't stopping the Division of Enforcement from bringing cases, but maybe bring us up to date on the rulemaking as well as some key enforcement actions.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Susan. And just before I get started, I'll just note that the views I'm going to express are solely my own and don't necessarily reflect the views of the commission or the staff. So the SEC actually just very recently in March proposed a new slate of rules dealing with the cybersecurity arena. And some of those rules are focused on certain, they call them market entities. And so those will apply to clearing agents, they'll apply to certain broker dealers, they'll also apply to national securities exchanges, transfer agents, and certain other entities. And so some of those proposed rules include ones that require those entities to have policies and procedures in place for dealing with cybersecurity incidents, an annual assessment of those policies and procedures, a confidential disclosure to the SEC very soon after an incident occurs, and as well, they have to have public disclosures that customers and investors can easily find. And those disclosures have to include both the policies and procedures that they have in place for dealing with those risks, as well as policies and procedures and disclosures of incidents that they have had, so cyber breach incidents, within the last 2 years. So they have to make those easily accessible to the public as well. Those proposed rules for these covered market entities are pretty similar to the ones that the SEC proposed last year for investment advisors and for investment companies. And actually, the SEC announced that they were going to reopen the comment period for those rules from last year in light of the fact that there were some new proposed rules in March that are going to touch on those investment advisors as well as investment companies. And so one that I'll just mention are some amendments to, it's called Regulation SP. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with that. But SP requires broker-dealers, investment advisors, and investment companies to have policies and procedures in place to protect customer information. And so some of these proposed amendments touch on the cybersecurity risks. And so there's an incident response team that's part of the proposed rules where these entities, these registrants, would have to have an incident response team that can respond quickly to a cyber incident and also figure out how to deal with that. And then enhanced disclosure rules, notification for customers and clients of these registrants that would have to occur within 30 days of any breach that they become aware of. So those are the proposed rules that are out there that the commission has kind of put out there for comment. In terms of the enforcement perspective, I think we're very much focused on kind of the fundamentals of disclosure. So with respect to cybersecurity incidents, we want to know who knew about them, when they found out about them, what they knew about, and what they understood the scope of those breaches are, the nature of those breaches. And then we're also concerned about how companies are deciding what they should disclose about those. And so some of the recent enforcement actions, I think, kind of highlight those issues. And I think they speak to disclosure issues that have a long lineage, actually. So I think I can trace them back to at least 2018 with the Yahoo case. But these are cases where companies have disclosed that they have the potential of a breach or that there was a breach that occurred, but then didn't provide full and accurate information about either the scope of the breach or the fact that when they talk about a hypothetical breach, they actually knew that the breach had already occurred and did not disclose that. So the most recent case is one in March. It's the Blackbaud case. This was a software company that dealt with data for nonprofit organizations, and they were subject to a ransomware attack. And so they disclosed that the attack had occurred, but they indicated that the kind of more sensitive customer data, stuff like social security numbers and bank account information, that those had not been accessed by the bad actor. But then very shortly after that disclosure, people within the company, within Blackbaud, learned that that kind of data had actually been accessed. But there were no policies and procedures in place for that information to filter upward to the senior management. And so when the company made its quarterly disclosure in August, they didn't disclose that the scope of the breach, they didn't disclose that this had happened, that the sensitive information had been accessed. And they continued to talk about it as a hypothetical risk. And so that was the basis of that enforcement action. And then some of the more recent ones in the last couple of years include First American. It's one where, again, there was vulnerability for a lot of data. This was a real estate settlement agency. And the senior management wasn't aware that the vulnerability had existed, that people further down the ladder knew that there was this vulnerability and that there had been a failed remediation. And so that was a case about the disclosure policies and procedures that were insufficient at First American. And then the year before that, there was the Pearson case. This was I think it's a publisher. And they also had data that was accessed by bad actors. And in their disclosures, they talk about data that could be accessed or a hack that could happen. Without disclosing that they knew that such an attack had actually happened to them. And so that was another case where there was $1 million penalty assessed against that company. So that's a couple of the recent enforcement actions in the past couple of years, Susan.
Yeah, thank you. So, Luke, you're in the front lines. I mean, you are really working with the first responders on these issues. What are some of the things that you're seeing now, just the nature of attacks, the sophistication, maybe just give us an update of what you're seeing out there.
Sure. It's a decent mix, I would say, in a lot of ways, to just sort of recap. And I think there's some linkages to the Blackbaud issue and then how the threat landscape has influenced current levels of inquiry that we're also working with. some of our clients that are under an active, some sort of inquiry by the SEC or even other regulators. And I think there's some linkages there worth noting in that sense. But we're sort of coming off a period of time. Different statistics or information outlets will maybe even have varying degrees of information in terms of level of volume of attacks or certain types of attacks. But I'll just generally say we're coming off of a last couple years, particularly 2021 and into early 2022. We did see a significant rise in ransomware attacks in that particular period. There was some leveling out of that into 2022, despite perhaps what even some of my competitors might say in terms of the level of volume. But that said, there still have been sort of a maintaining level of damage caused by those cyber attacks. So even despite some decreases in ransomware, particularly in 2022, we saw the impact of those things somewhat either maintaining or even increasing in terms of the overall response costs, the level of customer information impacted, and so on. But ransomware was certainly a key issue over the last couple of years, although not quite now what it was historically. Other aspects, though, impacting organizations include other types of extortion. Kind of think CEO as a target or other situations around bug bounty and vulnerability disclosure. So just one kind of dynamic in the cyber landscape is vulnerabilities that we're finding in software and in the enterprise from a technology standpoint, those have actually increased and continue to go up with some of the layering on of technology, I would call it, crypto, AI, and continued adoption of cloud and software as a service. But ultimately, interestingly, the landscape of vulnerabilities is increasing, but there is some lack of tracking with that to some extent right now by the threat actors. Mm-hmm. We know that threat actors are aware of these vulnerabilities. There's still some, I think, some macroeconomic nuances in play in terms of aspects of the crypto markets, the valuations there. I think informally there are some correlations to cyber threat activity to what those crypto markets are doing from an asset valuation standpoint. That's all sort of unofficial science from my vantage point, but I do think that there is some of that and still continued impact from the crypto winter. But certainly there's still issues impacting from a cyber threat activity perspective, not what we saw from an overall volume standpoint in 2021 and 2022. But again, just to summarize, a little bit of leveling out, but still the impact is quite high when they are occurring.
What kind of discussions are you having with clients about disclosure? Because that's really the key with all of the SEC's cases is, did you tell us? Did you tell us soon enough? Were you telling us accurately? Had you gotten all of the information? And there's always a real pull in wanting to fully investigate versus going in and telling the SEC or another regulator, because that might leave some sort of a trail. And you know, particularly with some of the proposed rules, which are requiring early disclosure. How are your clients dealing with that, and how do you work with them about disclosure decisions?
In full disclosure, pun intended, we have a little bit of sample set bias in the sense that we're oftentimes at StoneTurn dealing with firms that have some level of not just the impact and the immediate cleanup of it, but they have already sensed or are sensing, you know, perhaps readiness of regulatory inquiry, civil or class action dynamics potentially brewing. And so we're kind of coming in at a point oftentimes where there's anticipation of greater scrutiny. And with some of that, though, we have seen the regulators, particularly the SEC, make some level of inquiry, candidly quite consistently with the Blackbaud matter. So the evolution that we've seen from First American to Blackbaud, at least from a you know, precedent setting, enforcement action, very much levels of scrutiny. And I would just say new in the sense that the level of scrutiny has taken on a much higher level of sophistication by the SEC than we've seen in some number of years. So I would say that in compliments, actually, in terms of the level of awareness of the types of prescriptive security controls they're interested in. So buzz terms for cyber practitioners like myself are endpoint threat monitoring, advanced analytics, log management, and the like. And we're really seeing a high level of detail looking into not just what those controls produced, but what the teams on the incident response team, the cohesion between their findings and what might be disclosed, perhaps managing risk on what they're also going to market with in terms of their PR and reputational management. Really high levels of coordination are required now.
Yes.
With that, but then also the defensive managers or awareness of what other regulators may take issue with or concern with. I don't want to step ahead, but there are some integration points with other regulator activity, particularly NYDFS for financials in New York.
Yeah, go ahead and talk a little bit about that.
Sure. So some of it touched on a little bit in terms of what the organization knew when, the dynamics are what would a reasonable shareholder, and I'm not an attorney, but you know, what would a reasonable shareholder want to be aware of? And there, you know, are different levels of investigation that incur throughout the postmortem that an organization or perhaps an enforcement agency might want to do for that cyber incident. And so things such as were there alerts seen? When were they seen? How did the organization respond to those? And then again, how did certain information filter itself up for different decision making or awareness that was disclosed? I think some other things, though. I think SEC is very focused on disclosures. David mentioned aspects of customer information. I would say there are opportunities taken by other regulators that are more highly focused, I would say, in some cases around the consumer information. The big headline today, in fact, was the European regulator on Meta, a $1.2 billion fine in terms of the flows of consumer information. Not a cyber incident per se, but at least organizations, you can imagine a global organization that collects consumer information, the awareness that they need to have now, governance and the like around their data. But when the cyber incident occurs, the bar is much higher in terms of their overall awareness on hygiene protections, as well as assurances onto the impacts that potentially have or could have occurred to that consumer information.
Great. Hemma, you're from a compliance standpoint, this has to be something that you know you're wringing your hands constantly. So, how do you balance just you know some of the disclosure requirements, what the SEC's expectations are, with just making sure that there's a you know that you have a smooth you know ability to try to find out what happened and stop it.
Right. Well, I mean, I always like to add a fourth mission for the SEC, which is driving innovation, because there's glass half full and glass half empty. And we could be very intimidated and overwhelmed. I think we all are in many ways for other topics we're going to talk about today. The other way to look at it is it does drive rigor. It does drive hygiene, data governance, and for you to look creatively for ways in order to tackle the so many various issues that come up. So I work at Zendesk. I just inherited security compliance. Yeah. I could have been overwhelmed. I'm like, oh, thank you very much for giving me that under my hat. But then you have to find the priorities. You have to find, and I would say, what are we selling? I mean, I think that's what the SEC is asking. What are you selling to your customers and your investors? And what are you saying you're doing? And then are you finding the best ways to do it? I can tell you from the inside, I can see all the ways it can go wrong, for sure.
Yeah.
Right? And that can be overwhelming and paralyzing. In fact, it can chill innovation because you start thinking, oh, it's just better if we do less and say less and offer less and promise less. But I like the opportunity we're being given to find better ways to do data collection, data governance, data integrity. So you said hygiene is a good one, because we want to be able to sell better products. And Zendesk is a good example. We're a software as a service company, but I don't say that we sell software. I say we sell security. We sell protection of our customers' assets. That's what we're really selling. And without that, we've got nothing to sell. By the way, that's how I get my resources for my team. It's like, if you don't protect this rigor and this governance piece, we call ourselves governance, risk, and compliance, and we mean that. It's like, how do you incrementally put your teams on a journey where they are enhanced? I think we're going to cover this with the ESG piece, but you don't say you've arrived. I think that's the mistake, right?
Right.
You're safe with us. It's a hard thing to say with the developments that you've highlighted. I mean, I think what we're saying is we care and we're doing everything we possibly can. And maybe that's too much, right? Everything we can to go on a journey where you are best protected at our company. I think that's what we want to be able to sell, is that we care and we're trying, and then we'll come to it. Don't overstate what you're able to achieve, given the reality is it's a moving target.
No, I think that's right. That's great practical advice. Let's skip ahead to ESG, which is yet another very, very hot topic that we could spend a full day on. But, Hemma, give us, that's also subject to some very, very complicated rulemaking right now that's been very controversial and subject to a lot of comments. But Hemma, give us just a brief overview, if you would, of the rules and what we can expect.
Right, no, I will. I mean, it's a common theme of what I just said, but what we're looking at is the SEC and others saying, who cares wins is the name of a UN study on ESG, but don't say that you care. Don't make these proclamations if you can't show it, number one. And number two, just in recognition that investors and customers care more about the ESG, the climate and ESG issues, and they're going to want to rely on the accuracy and the quality of the things you're saying, the disclosures, there needs to be some rigor around it. So it's the same thing. The SEC put into place some proposed rules both for public companies and for issuers. Part of that, again, is just the very simple rule we know. Disclose the risks that might have a material impact on your business operations, or reasonably likely to have a material impact, and also some specific disclosures that are considered material. So greenhouse gases, for example, the scope one, the scope two. I won't go into detail on those, but it makes sense that investors want to do that. And I think the SEC is trying to provide some rigor around those disclosures and some requirements. Someone on another panel made the point about a lot of us being ahead of the rules. So we know there are proposed rules. We're hoping we get some clarity from the US in October of 2022. All the news is that we'll probably get some clarity this year. Yeah. I will say in the defense of the SEC, I'm really impressed by the comment process with this one in particular. They were overwhelmed by comments, especially by issuers and funds and advisors that are working globally and having things thrown at them from every part of the globe. So I think you're probably all aware that the European Union is doing a lot of work here. Also Asia, APAC's catching up. And so there's lots and lots of theory about what should be done and how. And some of us, Zendesk, Disney, and Snapchat, all three of them that I've worked at, are global companies that have to think about all of those things. The other part about us being ahead sometimes is that you might decide, I'll just wait and see what the rules say. But your customers are not waiting, your supply chain's not waiting, your investors are not waiting. And so while you're waiting, people are being, again, creative and trying to find the best, most efficient way to put in this governance, this data collection, this data integrity, this data reporting, and I would also say monitoring and testing, so the third-party insurance as well. I laugh because every time a new rule comes out, you create a whole new industry. How many of you have been contacted by ESG experts and vendors that want to be able to help you with this journey? Again, I'll just highlight that it is a journey. I think the SEC expects us to go on a journey. If you read the proposed comments, the comments, the proposed rules, you'll see just how much diversity there is in approach to this. I find it fascinating, really, that we're going to come to a proposal at some point. But it's obviously very experimental. And again, what we try to do is take a framework, take a governance framework, and apply it. And a good example of that is we're talking about non-financial disclosures largely now, but we've got excellent rigor on the financial disclosures piece. So one short way to tackle this behemoth is to take the best practices you've already applied when it comes to the financial disclosures and build those frameworks out for the non-financial. So I'm seeing a lot of work there because it's going to sound like a sob story, but the companies don't suddenly get resources. to tackle ESG or new threats in cyber. And so you've got to find ways to be lean and responsive.
Yeah, I mean, from Luke, from your perspective, what are you seeing on the ESG front? We've heard that part of the G is data governance. So maybe talk a little bit about that.
Sure, and I can speak in certain enterprise risk kind of capacities that sometimes I advise on, or some of my partners, particularly across the spectrum, environmental, some key areas in our world are carbon footprint and developing different, greenhouse action plans and the like. Some of my energy colleagues are heavily focused in that way. From a social perspective, we treat that. Some of the linkages there are aspects of investigations and anti-crime, anti-fraud practices. We view that as a social duty, and so we're advising our clients on that, not just cyber, but across that spectrum. And in terms of governance, fortunately or unfortunately, our view oftentimes is in a remediation context. And sometimes, at least in a cyber incident perspective, those are good indicators of the health of the broader governance framework that Hemma mentioned, in terms of there are logical intersection points there, not just with cyber, but across the governance spectrum, and they do have linkages with one another. Data is partly, data hygiene is partly a cyber issue. Mm-hmm. It's also has other aspects of hooks into the business. And so I would say that piece, but in remediation, boards especially are, at least real time in the immediate aftermath, are interested in what their level of completion is oftentimes to a particular remediation plan. So when I'm advising boards, they're obviously coming off of some sort of impactful event. They're going to want to maintain visibility on average, I would say, about a year. Mm-hmm. If they've had some sort of consent order or some other inquiry, they have some level of more detailed visibility than they normally would. And I would say there's some commonality beyond just cyber issues in terms of that briefing level there. And then, from that vantage point, let's say transition out of some of that remediation, they're thinking about what quarterly risk management should look like. Are we managing threats? How is, to Hemma's point, are we on a journey, and what are the stages and high levels of that? And then I think the final piece is, how are we assessing risk on an ongoing basis? And we may talk about that a little bit later, but some of that means, it doesn't sound very exciting, but what does the yearly risk assessment process look like, and is that adaptive to kind of current state in our market, regulator inquiry, et cetera?
I mean, it almost seems, and I don't know if this is, this is a question really, for David, but when you look at the cases that the SEC has brought on cyber as well as on ESG, it's really that there wasn't a process to decide whether or not there should be a disclosure. And just in many cases, particularly on the cyber side, the right hand didn't know what the left hand was doing. The IT people were solving the problem, and legal had no idea what was happening. So it seems like, David, is that the kind of thing that the SEC, if I'm walking in with a client and saying, please don't bring an action against this because we had a process in place, maybe we didn't disclose as quickly as the SEC may have thought we should have, but we had a process and there was a reasoned way for us to determine materiality. How would you look at that?
Yeah, I think you're right, Susan, that from the enforcement perspective, we're looking at these disclosures and assessing them from a pretty traditional framework. We're looking at, were these statements false? Were they material, and did they harm investors? And we also look at, just as you're pointing out, policies and procedures. Did the company have policies and procedures in place so that they could gather the information necessary to understand the risks, to understand the disclosures that they're making, and make a proper assessment as to whether they are being complete and accurate in the disclosures that they're putting out through their filings or other public statements? And I think that's, I think these ESG, the major ESG cases that have come out of the commission in the past year, I think kind of illustrate that we are still looking at it using these kind of fundamental tenets of disclosure and what a public company needs to do in terms of its disclosures. So a couple I'll touch on. The first one I'll mention is the Activision case. Mm-hmm. So that's a case that came out pretty recently. And it's a case where there was a $35 million penalty against this computer, a video game company. And there were two violations that that the commission found with respect to Activision. And so the first was that Activision, in its SEC filings, had specifically called out a potential risk to their business with regard to employee retention and the ability to attract new talent to their company. However, what the commission found through its investigation was that there were no policies and procedures in place at that company in order to properly collect, assess, and analyze complaints that employees had about workplace misconduct, which is something that has a direct bearing on employee retention and the ability to attract future talent. Managers at that company were also not required to submit those upwards so that senior management could become aware of those complaints. And so as a result, the commission found that there were not policies and procedures in place at that company that would allow for the proper collection of information relevant to these disclosures. And so that was an Exchange Act Rule 13A15 issue. Activision also had a separate issue where they were making their employees, when they left, sign a standard separation agreement that required those employees to notify the company if they either provided information to government agencies or had been contacted to provide information to government agencies, including the SEC. And the SEC, by statute, has very robust protections for allowing people to bring complaints to the SEC and to blow the whistle. And so that was another violation of an SEC rule in that those standard separation agreements were impeding employees' abilities to contact the SEC. Another case I'll touch on briefly is the Vale case. I think it's pronounced Vale, but it's a Brazilian mining company. And I think it's the biggest iron ore producer in the world. And they had a very catastrophic event in 2019 where one of the dams in Brazil that they managed collapsed. And it was just an environmental and human tragedy. 270 people died in that collapse. There was widespread environmental damage as a result of that collapse. And for the company, from their perspective, they lost about $4 billion of market cap as a result of that. And they had consistently, in their sustainability reports and in other public announcements, they had consistently said that their dams were held to the strictest international standards. There was 100% compliance with that. And as it turned out, the company actually knew that their dams were not in compliance with international standards. And so the SEC actually filed that as a litigated action. And I believe there was a motion to dismiss that was filed by the company that wasn't ultimately resolved by the court. The company actually just reached a settlement in March with the SEC, and so they paid, I think it was $25 million in a penalty and $31 million of disgorgement. And so that's another one of the prominent ESG cases that have come out recently.
Right.
And Susan, just one final issue I'll touch on the ESG side is that we've also seen, kind of as interest in ESG issues have hit the public and investors, we've also seen a proliferation of funds that have created products that claim to be ESG focused or only touch on or environmentally and socially conscious type funds. And so enforcement action within the last year was one against the Goldman Sachs asset management company, where they didn't have policy, going again to policies and procedures, they didn't have policies and procedures in place as they were assessing the securities to add to a fund that purported to be ESG focused. And then even when they did implement policies and procedures for how to research those funds and figure out those securities and figure out ESG issues, the people at the company were not following those policies and procedures. So that's another example of the SEC's focus on both policies and procedures as well as disclosures.
No, that's great. One last topic, and then we'll get everyone's final thoughts just on risk assessment and the like. SPACs. So I remember 3 years ago, that was the big topic, that, you know, this was an alternative way for companies to go public. And then it's just stopped. And, you know, the SEC has proposed new rules, and certainly there have been some enforcement actions. So, David, touch briefly on SPACs and just the state of things right now.
Sure. Absolutely, Susan. So SPACs, they really took off in 2020 and 2021. There were over 610, I think, transactions in the SPAC space in 2021. And so SPACs are these shell companies, basically, that are created, that go public, and they have sponsors and investors. And that gives them access to a pool of money that they can then use to go out and try to acquire a private company. And then that private company, through that process, it's called de-SPACing, then becomes basically a public company. And we've seen that with some prominent companies, like WeWork, for instance, was a SPAC. Nikola, I believe, was a SPAC as well. And there are some advantages to the SPAC process. I think it's a faster process. It allows the private companies to have a better valuation of itself. As you can all anticipate, it's also rife for potential abuse by bad actors. And sometimes people are looking to skirt the disclosure requirements that you would normally associate with an IPO by going the SPAC route. And so it's definitely been a focus of enforcement. The commission itself, in the rulemaking process, has proposed a number of rules that are out there for comment right now that the commission expects to finalize sometime this year. These are ones that are trying to bring the disclosures that SPACs have to make more in line with what you would expect from a traditional IPO. Increased disclosures on the financial projection side as well. Resolving the question of whether these transactions involve the exchange of securities, and also providing more clarity around whether SPACs fall within the Investment Company Act or not. There have been some enforcement actions on this side, too, to address kind of bad acts that are happening in the SPAC space. And a couple of the prominent ones in the last year involve conflicts of interest with respect to registered investment advisors. So there's one called Perceptive, where the people at the investment advisor were allowed to invest in some of the sponsors. They had ownership interest in some of the sponsors of SPACs that they then advise clients to invest in or to invest in the transactions in. And so it was this undisclosed conflict of interest that created the problem under the Investment Advisors Act. And we've seen a very similar case come out in the recent months called Corvex as well, dealing with a very similar failure to disclose a conflict of interest. What we've also seen is that the SPAC space is just rife with the potential for kind of more traditional types of fraud. So there was a case that was brought last year, and I'll just look up the name. I don't have it off the top of my head, but it was a case involving a person named Cooper Morgenthau, who was the former CFO of a SPAC, and he was raising money for a sponsor for a SPAC. And instead of investing in the sponsor, he then misappropriated that money, so basically an embezzlement case. Another kind of more traditional fraud that has occurred in the SPAC space as well is a case involving a person named Sean Wigofsky, who was accused of insider trading by the commission. And so this is somebody who had advanced knowledge of SPAC transactions that were going to occur, and then tipped a friend and then traded in advance of those. So we've seen both kind of more traditional types of fraud as well as these conflicts of interest type issues that are more specific to the SPAC space. And I think here in enforcement, we've been focused on all of that and keeping an eye on that.
Thanks. So with the few minutes that we have left, I thought we could get, you know, each of your takes on just this rapid sense of rulemaking and how that affects, you know, what you're doing. And Luke, we wanted to talk about risk assessment. So how do you think ahead and look beyond and try to become more proactive versus reactive on that front?
Sure. From my vantage point, I'm limiting risk assessments only to when something isn't going wrong is not necessarily the best course of action. And I say that in the way that, you know, throughout even an incident, you really kind of have to also have a mind of risk management in terms of thinking how outsiders might think about how you're even responding to an incident, what you're disclosing. So I think just from a risk management standpoint, and there's attorneys, you know, very well suited to do this more than I am in terms of what makes it to disclosures, but ultimately, too many organizations in terms of their preparation or response aren't necessarily thinking about broader risk management, because if they were, they'd probably be disclosing differently, and we wouldn't see these issues coming to the surface in that sense. But in terms of a proactive risk assessment, in terms of what the, just to be pragmatic about it, one of some of the more recent guidance in a consent order from NYDFS and Part 500 specifically around cyber, you know, kind of looks at the adequacy of the risk assessment process. And at minimum, yearly is what most enterprises should be thinking about, especially those that are heavily regulated. We saw last year, particularly spearheaded in many ways by the SEC cyber guidance, add that by a multiple in terms of the number of regulators that were either sending out cybersecurity guidance, making it more official, or kind of setting precedent with other enforcement actions. FTC in particular is extremely active. One is, I believe it was Chegg Education that mm-hmm. got into specifics in terms of their broader risk management and overall security hygiene. So all these things are still rapidly evolving, and there's really no one size fits all to them. They really are nuanced to the business, the critical information, customer information, how quickly they're evolving from a technology standpoint, a whole host of factors. But I would just say you need to have a recurring risk assessment process is the bottom line.
And that falls right to you, Hemma. How in the world do you stay ahead of all of these proposed rules and trying to, you know, have an effective and robust compliance program?
Look, we accept risk assessment as the foundation of an effective compliance program. That said, we don't want to be defensive. We want to be defensible. And that means you have to have risk assessment that does two things. It tells you about the vulnerabilities that you're exposed to based on your actual company's activities. Can't be just what's in the news or what Google has talked about in his latest speech. It has to be, what's my company doing right now? What are their goals this year? What is that? Where does that put them? What activities they're involved in? And what vulnerabilities does that surface? It can't be a guessing game. We're all very creative. We can write long, long lists and create risk registers and then, you know, get some experts to help us with the controls. And what we do is we overwhelm our teams. And I want to focus on that for a moment, because we are all very smart and can do these things in theory, but one of the risks that I try to assess for on a continuous basis is the cultural factors and the operational factors that are impacting my team. Because if I'm throwing too many policies at them, and we know, our friends at the SEC who used to be there, they're going to talk about, do you have a policy? And if you do have a policy, is it being enforced? I think the JP Morgan case is an example of that. So it's almost like you don't want to just keep throwing more documentation that says more policies, more rules, more controls, more testing, more monitoring, and setting your teams up to fail. So for us, the risk assessment really is part of that. It's like, where are we becoming the office of no? Or where's the disconnect now between compliance and legal and the actual, you know, where are you losing trust, quite frankly? And so the highest risk for me is losing trust. That we're irrelevant to the business and we can't explain to the SEC why we had these beautiful processes written down, but people just didn't follow them consistently. And so that's the ephemeral issue with me. And I like to try, with risk assessment, I like to try to make sure the risk assessment is designed not only to track the vulnerabilities that we've talked about a few today, and you said there's so many, to look around the corner, sure, what's emerging risk for our industry and our business, but really, what's the risk of burnout? You know, what's the risk of not having some behavioral science in your program, not having some co-creation in your program? And the best way I find to do that is to do co-creative risk assessment. So rather than a top-down, we'll tell you what the vulnerabilities are and we'll tell you what to do, we start asking, So I call it coaching for compliance, right? We get to the business team. We say, oh, look, you want to do this new thing in this new jurisdiction in this new way. Let's talk about the types of vulnerabilities there are based on our knowledge of the legal rules and how we might effectively mitigate those. And once you've got that buy-in, it's just much more concrete. And that's why I mentioned the journey. You have to put your teams on a journey and a culture of compliance, because otherwise all we're doing is saturating them. And I used to walk around the DC office, just one last thing, and I'd look around, I'd think to myself, gosh, this is a big building, and there's a lot of us that work in here. And I only really need to know what I'm working on today. But the companies need to know something about everything that's going on in this building and beyond. So I think the way we handle that is objective-centered risk assessment, focus on what matters to them. You know, I like to say what matters to them is making money. So how do we have them make money in a better way, like align with their objectives?
Great, great last pieces of advice. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Susan. Great job.